I would like to introduce Dr. Karthik Pondicherry, who happens to be the speaker for today's webinar. Dr. Pondicherry has a doctorate in tribology from the University of Leoben in Austria. With over a decade of experience in the field of tribology, Dr. Pondicherry managed the global tribology portfolio at Antenpard in Graz, Austria until the end of 2019. He later moved to India and started as a technical manager for rheology at Antenpard India. Over the past year, Dr. Pondicherry has conducted numerous seminars and trainings for people for both academia and industry across the globe. Welcome, Dr. Pondicherry, and over to you now. I think you can start with the presentation.
So thanks a lot, Richa. Firstly, namaste to everyone. I hope you're all doing well and keeping good health. And it's a privilege to actually be a part of this Bharat Ka Amrit Mahotsav, and advance greetings to all of you. So today we'll be talking a little bit about rheology and tribology and concentrate more on the dreaded products, how to investigate them, what all you can do. And, you know, if you talk about rheology per se, then you'll say that, okay, this is science of deformation and flow behavior of materials. And since we are concentrating on food materials, we are going to tend towards more of viscous or viscoelastic materials and not so much about solids. Of course, if you're talking about biscuits and stuff, you can go to the solid realm as well, but we will try to stick to the more viscous and elastic part or viscoelastic part. And to understand that, we take help of rheology. And the question comes, like, scientific, you know, I wouldn't call it like inquisitiveness or something, but one of principal questions that one actually asks in science is why. To the question, why rheology? Because if you think about food, you can imagine that it undergoes a lot of processes during its lifetime, right? From the time it's, you know, sown to reaped, processed to, you know, taken through silos or, you know, pumped through tubes and all these kind of things. And those processes, and we are not even talking yet about the interesting thing that happens to food in our oral cavity, like the bolus formation and the rheological properties of that and so on and so forth. But even the processing phase of food, you have a lot of rheology going on, and you will see that later as well, what I'm talking about. So that apart, when you talk about the feeling of food in the mouth, okay, this is about wine. I found this very easily, so I thought like I'd present this, which makes, should I say, it a bit more easier to understand. So if people have consumed wine, I know that's a taboo in many places, but don't mind me bringing up this reference. You will see that it has different flavors, it has different feelings, like astringency, which is more to do with chemistry, and then fleshy feeling, or, you know, citrusy feeling, or you have some oak feeling and this feeling and that feeling. So all of them have something to do with the interaction of wine in our oral cavity through saliva and all kinds of you know, sensory receptors in our oral cavity. So if one would like to go and analyze it through people, right? Like you call in a sensory panel and then analyze it, then the problem is that you will have a lot of tests to be run through the sensory panel, and they're not even very reliable. They are reliable, but not that reliable, because humans feel things differently. Each individual is an individual, so they have different perception of food as well. So that brings us to a point where we say, okay, is there any instrumental method of doing this? Of course, that's one part of it. The second part of it is how to improve the efficiency, how to improve the productivity, how to improve the, or not even like improvement. If you're trying to make things economic and then, you know, source the materials from somewhere else, or add different or substitute existing materials, and you want the same feeling and the same kind of texture to the food, same kind of feel to the food, then how are you going to compare the past product or the original product or the product that you're developing now? So all these things are more in the realm of getting a number. You know, when you're running a sensory panel or when you're running a test, if you're able to get a trend, a number, you can pin onto it, then you can say, okay, my existing product is going to, or my future product is going to feel the same way like my existing product, then you say that, okay, I am successful to the most extent. So that is one part of it, why we do it. And then very quickly, we'll go through the basics. As I said, you have viscous materials, you have elastic materials, and then like you can think about water as viscous, and then elastic, you can just imagine the chair that you're sitting on is elastic material because it's not it's not flowing per se, and also when you apply a little bit of force, then it'll bend, but it'll come back to its original state, and so on and so forth. But there are a number of things, like you take curd, you take butter, you take this and that, they fall under the category of viscoelastic because they have a little bit of elastic behavior and a little bit of viscous behavior. How much of it is viscous and how much of it is elastic is what we are going to determine through rheology. And that's not rotational rheology, that would be oscillatory rheology. So this is the two-plate model that we will be using for viscous behavior. So the Newtonian behavior, so to say. So here you have two plates. You have the sample, and then you apply a force, you shear it, and then you get the displacement. The area is fixed, the height is known. So from that, you get the force and the area, you get the shear stress and the velocity, displacement over time. And then the height here, you're going to get the shear rate. And simply from that, you're going to get the dynamic viscosity, which is the ratio between the shear stress and shear rate. And times Isaac Newton back in the 17th century, we got this from him. So next part, viscoelasticity, as I said, there you are trying to figure out the viscous part and elastic part. And we'll deviate from the Newtonian behavior and come on to something called as a Hookean behavior. I'm not sure how, this is basic physics, actually. We are not going into deep. So when you have a spring, you add a load, you are going to elongate it. Add a little bit of more load, twice the load in this particular case, then you have twice the elongation. And this sits very well with the Hookean behavior, which says that the elongation or extension is directly proportional to the force, and the constant is the spring constant. We apply the same thing for shear as well, and then the ratio between the stress and the strain is going to give you the shear modulus. But still, you do not have like the division between the viscous and elastic pattern. That will come in the next slide, actually. And if you compare the viscosity with the shear modulus, you might see that there's a lot of similarity, but honestly, this is shear rate here and this is shear strain here. So to understand that, as I said, we need oscillatory measurements. And then without going into deep, you will see that you have the stress amplitude and the strain amplitude and something called as a phase shift delta, which is the lag or lead between the input and output. So you take the stress amplitude, the strain amplitude, you get the ratio, the absolute value is G star, which is complex modulus. And when you plot G star at an angle delta, you're going to get the storage modulus and the loss modulus as the X and Y intercepts respectively. We do not have to bother about this at this moment, because this is all done by the software, but it is important to just understand that, okay, this is how we get there. And this is all there is to equations as of now. And when we come to rheometry, as you have seen up until now, we only talk about stresses and strains. The rest of the things are in the periphery. You'll talk about the temperature, pressure, humidity. You are going to apply them. And then what you're going to see is what happens to my strain when these parameters are changed when I apply a certain amount of stress or vice versa. So there's no rocket science here. It's as simple as that. So to do that, we use something called as rheometer. And imagine if you put your sample over here. Let me just change this for a second. Pointer options. So if you put your sample here and you're going to shear it, then you're going to rotate the shaft here. And that rotation happens because of a motor here. So you can imagine having a handle bicycle handle, and you're trying to rotate it. It only rotates about its axis to a certain extent. And you will also see that it's not going forward or backward, it's fixed. And that is because you have something called as a ball bearing sitting at multiple locations. Great. But we cannot use a ball bearing here. You could, people do use it. We do use it as well. But what happens is that the torque consumed by the ball bearing is going to impact your results. So what we did further is simply use something called as air bearing. So an air cushion separating the shaft and the housing so that we can get very, very sensitive measurements and as sensitive as 0.5 nanonewton meters. So how much is it? So you extend your arm, you put a grain of sand, and the force that exerts on your shoulder is what you can measure with this instrument, or even more sensitive. So that being said, what all can you do? You can look at the influencing parameters. You can look at the structural change. So if you have some if you're cooling or heating, what's happening, if you're applying shear. So you can do it through microscopy, you can do it through spectroscopy, Raman spectroscopy, for instance. You can do dynamic mechanical thermal analysis for food products as well. You can do tribology, where you do deal with friction and lubrication, and you can analyze powders. Powders are used quite a bit in the food industry. And then, of course, starch. So now we come to the more interesting aspect of this talk, and that would be about practical example. So here you have ice cream and influence of temperature. Okay. So when you think of an ice cream, I mean, I don't know the weather back in where you all are, but here it's quite rainy. So we're not so much into ice creams right now, but you can imagine we just had summer a few weeks ago. So when you are eating an ice cream, there are multiple things that you have to think about. How easily you can spoon it, okay? When you put it in your mouth, melting is more about thermodynamics. We are not going to concentrate much on that. But is it easy to spoon? When you put it in your mouth, how does it feel? Is it creamy? Is it sticky? Is it flowing easily? So there are a lot of things that you can think about even in terms of an ice cream. So here we have two rheograms. I'm not going to tell you how exactly we got them because that would go too much into the test methodology and stuff. But you can imagine that here you have oscillatory measurements done at a strain of 0.02% at a frequency of 10 radians per second. So again, so both the frequency and the, how do you say, amplitude were kept constant, and the temperature was increased at a set rate. Okay, perfect. What you see here is G prime, G double prime. G prime gives you the elastic characteristic of material. So that's the storage module. And G double prime gives you the viscous characteristic of, or it's also called the loss modulus. And here you can see that E1, so ice cream, like the sample E1, as you increase the temperature, it is dropping quite considerably. And E2 is dropping less. That means over here, you still have a bit of, let's say, not such a significant drop. And also what you see here, that even as the temperature increases, G prime of E2 is higher, which means that it will still give you creamier feel at the consumption temperature, so to say. So that is that. And then here, this means that it's better spoonable and so on and so forth. So you can read these from these graphs. And also what's important is that once you read this, you corroborate these with what you see from the field data, and then you can create something called as models. And once you have these models, you can pre-screen materials, which you'll see later what I'm talking about, and then make your process more efficient, not just in terms of the time wise, but also in terms of the money that's being put into that process. So economic aspects. So now we can talk about cheese. So cheese, of late, there's been a huge increase in cheese demand in India as well. Earlier, about 30 years ago, this was not the case, at least what we in South have experienced. And when one talks about cheese, the first thing that nowadays people can think about is, let's say, pizza, right? So, again, there are characteristics, right? Like when you have a pizza, it needs to have certain character. What's that? Okay, the cheese layer. So there are campaigns on the cheese, like cheese in the crust, cheese, like cheese spreading, and the stringiness of cheese, and this and that of cheese, and how it melts in your mouth, how you feel it in your mouth. So there's a lot of thing going around cheese as well in this business. So what is important? That apart, like the feeling apart and this apart and that apart, when we say, okay, you're processing this cheese, or when you're actually applying this cheese on a pizza, let's say, you can figure out how efficiently it will melt, how efficiently it will spread, and once it's melting, how well like it's distributing about. Because if you think about the process of pizza making, I'm sure everybody might have seen how a pizza is made. So you have the dough nicely spread in terms of a circle, a nice round circle, and then you pour some nice tomato sauce onto that, spread it well, and then you add the cheese. And cheese, you're not putting it in sheet form or something. You actually have this shredded cheese or something, and then you just spread it around. And that when you put in the oven after putting the toppings, of course, that when melted has to spread evenly. And it has to melt at a certain temperature. It shouldn't overspread, because if it overspreads, you can actually have it crawl out of the pizza and onto the oven floor. And that is going to make your oven messy. So too much detail, but still you have to think about all these things when you're planning for, especially at an industrial scale. So one of the biggest chains of pizza makers in India actually uses 100% mozzarella cheese in their pizzas. So here you have, this is not amplitude, this is not frequency, this is just temperature. So again, you're seeing G prime and G double prime as a function of temperature. So you keep increasing the temperature and you see that the G prime is dropping. And at some point, you see that the G double prime is overtaking your G prime. And this could be understood as a crossover point where the characteristic of your sample, let's call it a sample, or your cheese sample is changing. What does that mean? After this point, your cheese sample literally starts to flow. The elastic component is decreasing or smaller as compared to the viscous component, which means it's entered into a flowing state. So if you consider water, for example, I mean, that's a very bad example, but still, let's say, then this will be somewhere up there, and then you won't even be able to see this part because it's almost zero. So yeah. So now the question is, what happens when you compare three different cheese? So here you have two mozzarella cheese samples and one Gouda cheese. So mozzarella is a bit of a mushy cheese, whereas Gouda cheese is more like a, I would not call it a solid, but it's quite much stiffer compared to mozzarella. So at temperatures where you would actually see them, like let's say even 30 degrees centigrade, the characteristics of both mozzarella A and mozzarella B are almost identical. Of course, Gouda cheese is much higher, so this indicates the stiffness. G star, from G star, of course, you're going to get the G prime and G double prime. So when you look at it, what you're seeing here is that up until a certain temperature, both are displaying similar characteristics. But once you increase the temperature, you're seeing that the stiffness of mozzarella A is even exceeding that of the Gouda cheese. So the next part is, when do they start to flow? To that, we cannot get the direct answer from the G star, but we make use of something called as tan delta. But before we go there, let's talk about reproducibility. So this is how reproducible these tests are, even with cheese samples being heated up. So tan delta is G double prime over G prime. So this is the loss modulus and the storage modulus. And when both are equal, tan delta is equal to 1. And that is when look, or when you say that your crossover point occurs. And this is where that line is. And you see that for these three different cheese samples, you have three different temperatures. Now the question could be, which one is more like, not more, which one is better and which one is worse? That is kind of hard to say, because that depends on multiple factors. Do you want your cheese to start flowing early? Do you want your cheese to still have a certain amount of stiffness even when it starts to flow? Because if it's stiff, it's not going to distribute uniformly. So there are a lot of considerations that need to be taken care of while deciding on which one is good and which one is bad. And that is the next step when you actually collaborate with people in field, get their input, and then decide, okay, this is good because of this, or this is bad because of that. So this doesn't have anything to do with dairy, but this is something which is also quite important. I didn't have anything with cheese on this part. So I said, okay, let's just put in some ketchup, add to that, because again, this is found very frequently in the joints that I've been mentioning. So if you're looking at this, you'll actually see that this one is more like, let's say, more or less structure, like the structure is more stiffer compared to this. So if you have experienced ketchup behavior, right? So when you look at ketchup in a bottle, it's quite viscous. And then you tap on it and squeeze it, it starts to flow. And that flow, once, because of sheer thinning effect, its viscosity decreases and starts to flow. But as soon as it falls on your fries, for example, is it going to recover its original structure or not? In this particular case, you can imagine that it recovered quite well. And in this case, it did not recover. Of course, it depends on the additives. It depends on the chains inside and so on and so forth. So here is an example how you can actually quantify it. So these are two ketchups. This Technic was actually devised, if I'm not mistaken, for paints and such. But as you know, in many fields, you discover or you create some kind of a test methodology for something, and then later you realize that, oh, voila, you can actually apply this in the other fields as well as effectively or even better than deviating very briefly off topic. Laser is a very good example of that. They actually discovered laser quite a while ago, but its applications came into being much, much later. So here, this is at low shear rate, indicative of rest. High shear rate, so you increase the shear rate, so you have shear thinning behavior. The viscosity is dropping by at least over an order of magnitude. And then see that when you bring it back to low shear rate, you're seeing a recovery. The question now is, how are you going to quantify this? So there are, again, many ways to do that. For example, you will see how much is my recovery compared to my original state. And then you say, or how much time will it take for me to recover in this particular case to 80% of my original value. In some other cases, it could be to 50%. In some other cases, it could be like 3 seconds. I mean, it all depends on your experience and then your sample and its behavior. So I would say that this recovers faster. So this would be more like this one, and this recovers slower. So that would be more like this one. The question again that might fall into people's heads is, which one is better? There is no concrete answer to that either, because it depends. Do I like a watery ketchup on my fries? Maybe yes, maybe no. I mean, it's about perception. Like, I like something, somebody else likes something else, but it is good to know that which behavior is described by which kind of a curve that you see in a rheogram. So again, stability issues. So if you can imagine that you have nice two products, and what's the connection today with this, you will see in a couple of slides from now anyways. So if you're looking at it, you have these salad dressings, and then wait for a moment and they will see that all the particles have just settled down. So there's a lot of things going on there, like depends on the particle size, it depends on the viscosity, it depends on, you know, mutual interaction between the particles and the base and so on and so forth. So not going into all that depth, the question is, how are you going to figure it out? Because it's all about the real life's problems and how to figure out the solutions or a way to determine if this is going to behave this way or this way. So you do something called as the frequency sweeps, wherein you're going to look at the G prime at low frequencies, which somehow indirectly indicates the behavior over longer periods of time. So if I just want to figure it out for a week or so, then I would just keep it on the shelf and say, okay, wow, staying still, or it's, you know, sedimenting. What if you want to figure out the behavior over 6 months or 1 year of time? So those kind of things need different kinds of measurement techniques, and that's what we are offering as well. For example, this is about chocolate drinks. So pure milk, you have chocolate milk plus, chocolate milk budget, that means a cheaper version of the drink, and then calcium enriched milk. So you have multiple things going on here. So if you look at the frequency curve, you will see that for both the premium products, your G prime is higher at lower frequencies, whereas that of this budget milk is quite low, or it's even tending to the x-axis for that matter. So stability of these two is much higher compared to this. And for pure milk, there is absolutely no stability, because, I mean, of course, we know that that's not that stable. So then here you have something else. So the shear dependence of these things. So at higher shear rates, how is your milk behaving? So as you can see, the enriched milk and the, how do you call this, Choco Plus milk have a higher G prime even at higher shear stresses, whereas that Choco Budget milk is going down. So if I am the producer of this milk, my aim would be actually to say, okay, how do I emulate this kind of a behavior in my budget product? So the question would be, right, great. Do I add something called as an additive, increases the gel strength, or which increases the structural integrity in my product? So here's a small example to show you that by increasing the amount of a certain additive, you're seeing that the G prime is increasing again by orders of magnitude. Of course, I'm not going to put 15% of it because, again, additives might be expensive and they might also have a counterproductive behavior by interacting with something else or so on and so forth. So this is just to illustrate that these things are possible and these things can be taken care of. So with that, we come to the next part of it, which deals with food tribology. So what exactly are we looking at? This is about the mouthfeel again. Why rheology and why tribology? So in our oral cavity, you have multiple processes going on. Like you have the bolus forming, and then here you have mechanical properties during biting. And then when your bolus passes between your tongue and the palate, then it becomes an actual tribosystem. So tribosystem is when you have two interacting surfaces with or without, let's say, a liquid or a fluid or anything in between them. So this is how we do it. So we have a ball, a glass ball, rubbing against three PDMS pins, polydimethyl siloxane pins. And this is how much sample you need. So this is a salad dressing, and then you need 1.5 to 2 milliliters of it. And then this whole thing sits in on a rheometer, and then we just run the test. For example, this is a sample. This was done about a few years ago, actually. And you see that even though you're having sliding velocity, this just started moving because these velocities practically don't have any motion because you're still in the static state. And what you're looking at is the friction coefficient as a function of the sliding velocity. Start moving, kinetic friction lower than static friction. And at some point, you will see that there is your kind of churn. I don't call it churning, but then you might even see some phase separation going on and so forth. So this is a cheese sample. And again, as I said, this was done by me almost like 8 years ago. So back then we were like moving into this field. So now we would have done it a bit differently, but it's a pretty nice way of demonstrating that how you're destroying your sample and how you're able to see the effect of what's happening here on your friction coefficient as well. So the question now is, how do you differentiate samples? And here you have a classic example of fat-free milk, low-fat milk, and whole milk. So these measurements were conducted also like quite some time ago. And what is important here is that you're looking at friction coefficient as function of sliding speed, and this is 10 nanometers per second. So you cannot imagine motion at that rate. And increase, and you are seeing that here you have a breakaway, and then increase again. And then at some point, you're having all, curves overlap each other, because in this part of this diagram, which is called the Strybeck curve, the rheology of the sample plays an important role. And since there's not much of a difference between the viscosity between three milk samples, they all overlap. But what's important is that here in this part, you see an absolute correlation between the fat content and the friction coefficient. And obviously, you can imagine that fat is supposed to lubricate, and that's what it's doing with the whole milk having the lowest friction coefficient and fat-free having the highest friction coefficient. And if you want to think about what speed does this go in our oral cavity, that speed would be something like 20 millimeters per second or 30 ms per second. And here you have two different chocolate samples and how they can be distinguished through these Strybeck curves, external Strybeck curve. So on the left, you have a very homogeneous sample. On the right, you have something more thicker, and you know you cannot guarantee when which part of the sample is going to come in between the two rubbing surfaces. So that's the behavior. And this behavior is not bad behavior, because again, as I said, you are seeing what is happening. Here, it's more homogeneous, so you're getting perfect reproducibility, but here you can't expect homogeneity, so you're getting these kind of results, and that also shows something. And once again, which is good and which is bad, we cannot say, because I personally might like something which is more consistent and more, you know, giving me a surprising feeling in my mouth, and I might not be that inclined towards these milky, silky chocolates. So here again, we have the effect of viscosity on the friction behavior of chocolate. So if you see, cocoa butter has the lowest viscosity and also has the lowest friction, especially in the so-called hydrodynamic regime of the Strybeck curves. And the higher the viscosity, the higher the friction, because here you have the viscous drag taking, and also in this. So to just sum it up, it's like you can figure out the effect of viscosity even on the frictional behavior. And from these, you can go a step further and then talk about the correlation between sensory perception and such data. And this again is something more about a beer. So people are going in for something like alcohol-free beer and so on and so forth. So how are you going to emulate the feeling of an alcoholic beer with that of a non-alcoholic beer? So vice versa, actually. So you add certain additives like, I don't know, glycerin or something, and then you try to emulate the same behavior so that people get the feeling but don't get intoxicated. So this is one such example. By adding parts per million, you're able to actually find such a significant difference between the behavior, especially in the low and mediums. And this is the effect of saliva. I'm going to skip this because we are just about a minute away from stopping. So the question now is, where is mouthfeel? So to figure that out, what we did is we collaborated with a major cheese manufacturer from south of Germany, Hochland, and they, along with another company called Invent Food, which is more of a research-based unit, figured out like how to develop a methodology. So this is the methodology. It's too much to read right now, so I'm not going into it. So you have the sample holder, sample pins, you have the cheese after the test, and then we ran 12 different cheese samples, and the results look like that. So again, I'm sorry that I keep bringing up the question, but it's all about the questions. You have to ask the right questions to get the right answers, right? So the question now is, how are you going to decipher these curves? Because since we are on the topic of food, this looks more or less like a spread up spaghetti, right? So the thing is, human perception of these curves can give you some idea, but not really much, because they are really jumbled and garbled and everything. So we take help of statistics. And as food scientists, I'm sure you are more well-versed with statistics than I am. So what we used is something called as a rolling correlation. People use Pearson correlation, this and that, and multivariate regression analysis. So there are lots of things that you can go on with. But what we did here is went for the rolling correlation. And as you can see, the darker it is, the greater the correlation. And what does this actually mean? This means that we are trying to find trends. So looking at these curves, where exactly is my friction increasing or decreasing in a similar trend as the sensory perception given by a sensory panel? So in this curve, you can see for stickiness that at 0.63 millimeters per second, where you got the best of the fitting or correlation, as the coefficient of friction increases, the stickiness is increasing, or vice versa, as the stickiness is increasing, the coefficient of friction is increasing, which is quite logical because stickiness has something to do with prevention of motion or prevention of things separating from each other, right? So again, there are outliers. Of course, there will be. I mean, not 100% foolproof. But what you can read out of this is that, okay, if I get a 14th sample, a 13th sample, right, and then I run a Schreiber curve, like you have seen those curves, and then at 0.63 millimeters per second, if I get a value of around 0.15, then I can say, okay, this is my curve, this is where it's sitting, and then I would say that it's somewhere between 3 and 5. I'm not going to say that it's 4 or 3.5, but I can say with a reasonable assurance that it's somewhere between 3 and 5. We validate such type of measurements, like this is kind of a model. You validate this model and then you're good to go. So then this is another thing where you talk about the fatty coating, and you are seeing that the increasing fatty coating, you're getting lower friction. And that again makes sense because fat is supposed to reduce friction. And with that, I come to an end of the session and would like to thank you all for your kind audience. And if you have questions, please let me know. And on a personal note, I would like all of you to please take care. The COVID situation has not yet subsided everywhere. And please mask up and please take care of yourself and your loved ones. Thank you.
So any questions?
Hello. There are a few questions in the Q&A actually. So yeah. Which geometry is best for ice cream? So you can actually use a cone plate geometry or a parallel plate geometry, and that should work pretty well. And so on graph, which frequency sweep is indicating more sedimentation? So that's slide 43, just go there. So I suppose this is what you're talking about, slide 44, if I'm not mistaken, because slide 43 is not. So here, what you're actually seeing is that if the G prime is falling down, okay, there's also other things that you can think about, like the crossover between G prime and G double prime, that would again be indicative of phase separation and other kinds of things. But the higher the G prime at lower frequencies, the better. So it's relative again, the better is its performance over longer periods of time. So the next question is, what is viscous drag? So you might have seen in the video that I've shown that at some point you have high rotation and then there's a lot of fluid coming in into the or you can call it the interface, and it will create something called as a lift, wherein let me just pull up a slide if possible where you can actually see what it is. Sorry, let me stop sharing for a second. So this is like about the basics of Stryber curves. I didn't want to go into it because I didn't want to. So when you talk about Stryber curves, let me share again. So this is what it is. So you have a shaft and a bearing, which looks like this. And the shaft is going to rotate inside the bearing, and you have the lubricant. So when you are at low speeds, you have surface to surface contact because you're not able to pull in the lubricant at this interface. But when you increase the speed, you can imagine that some of this lubricant is going to get entrained into the interface, and that will create a little bit of separation, which will reduce the friction because you don't have surface-to-surface contact. But when you increase the speed further, you will again see that a lot of lubricant is going in, and you can see that the thickness of the film is also higher. So if the viscosity is high, you can imagine that it will take a lot more effort to actually shear that thick film as compared to a thinner film. So that is what I'm talking about in terms of viscous drag. I hope that was clear. And then let me just check. There's another question actually. Okay, so there is a thing which says, why do you choose those variables? Okay, so yeah, what actually you do, I didn't go into the testing part of it because I want to focus more on application. So this particular thing is, how should I put it? When you're running an oscillatory measurement, you need to apply a certain amount of frequency and you need to apply a certain amount of amplitude. And frequency, you can say, okay, 1 hertz per second or 10 radians per second. I mean, it's not the same, one and the same. It's gonna be okay. But how are you going to choose the amplitude? So if you want to think about choosing an amplitude, let me again pull in a slide. Sorry if this is going back and forth. So just imagine putting your hand or like finger on your palm, okay, close to your thumb, and then start oscillating it very, very slowly, okay? And you will see that you're actually, whatever is happening there is principle only elastic in nature. And when you increase that, right, when you increase that particular amplitude, at some point you will start to...
Sorry for interrupting.
No, I am pulling up the slide. I'm pulling up the slide right away, but I'm trying to give a practical thing like how you will actually feel about it. So just, I'm pulling up the slide right away because it's in, okay, over here. So now you should be able to see the slide, right?
Yes.
So in principle, before you do any like a frequency sweep or a temperature sweep or a time sweep, you are expected to do an amplitude sweep because you need to determine at what amplitude and what frequency, of course, is a different story, but what amplitude you're going to run the test. Because as I said, once you increase the amplitude, you will see that you're going to rub your surfaces against each other. And the same thing you can imagine in terms of the structure inside your material. So once you cross the elastic boundary, then you are kind of breaking the structure. And that is exactly this point, as determined by the software, of course, that you are dropping the G prime by over 3% or 5%, depends. And then you're going to try to keep your other tests within this limit, which is called the linear viscoelastic regime. So you do the amplitude sweep, you get that LVER, and then you're going to use that for your future tests. And another point is that this, as I said, when you are crossing over between the G prime and G double prime, that is going to be a flow point. Is there something in chat? Okay, 1 second. Multiple things going at the same time. So there is a question, if I don't get reproducibility, why is this happening? So reproducibility in rheology, that you can address to a certain extent. So you can kind of homogenize the sample. You can wait for some time. You can ensure that the trimming is done properly. You can ensure that you're keeping it, you're using proper measuring geometries, and also you're avoiding air bubbles, you're filling in the sample properly. So there are a list of do's for rheology, and that will help you get better reproducibility. As far as tribology is concerned, I would say that at times, not getting reproducibility has nothing to do with the sample, the test or anything. It's the way it is. That can happen because things are a bit more dynamic in tribology, and one can have problem with reproducibility, but that doesn't mean that the test is wrong or the can anybody please confirm if I'm audible, please?
Yes, Karthik.
Yeah, Dr. Karthik.
Okay, perfect. Perfect. Thanks. So yeah, that is about that. And yes, you need to run an amplitude test first, and then you can fix the variables for the next measurements. So are there any other questions, please? Thank you.
Sunil sir, any question from your end?
Hello. Am I audible, Vishal?
Yes, sir. Completely audible.
Dr. Karthik, I have one question regarding the tribology aspects of this milk and milk products. Can we go for the tribology of milk powders?
The thing is, like, what exactly are you expecting out of it? Because I have personally done those things. So the question is, like, what are you expecting out of it? So
actually, we are looking for the mouthfeel aspects of milk powders after the hydration, how they are behaving mm-hmm. after hydrating.
Mm-hmm. So they are, like, for example, the research that I did was more towards figuring out the astringency behavior and so on and so forth of milk powders after, you know, they are hydrated. So we did that, and we figured out a methodology for that. And yes, we can do that. And other aspects. So if you're just hydrating it and want to know about some other aspects, like if it's stickiness, it's like creaminess and such, then it is just like we are doing with the other samples. You just make sure that the samples are created in a similar manner, and then run the test, and then run an analysis, and then figure it out. So it is absolutely possible.
Oh, okay. This is with respect to the hydration properties. If we move directly with the dried sample, means powder sample, can be directly
you can
put
do
your housing?
Not in tribology, but you can do it with our powder cell, actually.
Okay, we can do it in powder cell.
Yes, we have the powder cell, and that also gives you things like wall friction. It gives you the cohesive strength. It gives you the compaction behavior and so on and so forth.
For rheology.
It is powder rheology, yes.
Okay. Thank you.
So it can fit into our existing rheometers. Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Karthik.
Thank you. So are there any more questions, please?
I think this is over, Dr. Karthik. You have explained very well. I think it is over. We should move ahead.
So we are on the dot. Anyway, it's like 1:15. So once again, I would like to thank the organizers for giving us this opportunity. And yeah, this has been quite an interactive session as well. So please take care. And thanks again on behalf of Anton Parr. And please stay safe. Namaste.